After the Cold War, as the international conflicts diminished, the number of violence in the world increased. The conflicts that we observe materializing in the international system from the 90s onwards are increasingly affecting the civilian population disproportionately. So we are facing a new scenario. One of the elements that condition the scenario is, in a way, linked to the dynamics of the Cold War. During the Cold War, on the periphery of the international system, there was great violence. So we have a context in which the powers of the system projected the instability of the conflict between them and deployed it in peripheral countries. So what happens is that we have a polarization produced by the dynamics of the Cold War, where Cold War forces are investing in civil conflicts in these countries. When the Cold War ends, the powers lose interest in these countries and withdraw their investment, their troops, their advisors. In this, we have a process of brutal disruption and uncertainty, in which they resorted to more violence to obtain some degree of stability for that political community. There we have states weakened by the dynamics of the Cold War. This is important because we have a type of violence that starts to account for other important variables. We have violence in which the cultural element becomes fundamental in the process of political organization and production and reproduction of violence. We have the issue of gender, with a strong role in rape as a weapon of war. We have scenarios in which desertification and hunger are decisive in the willingness of certain groups to migrate to one side or the other. International warfare has drastically decreased, but violence hasn't. The humanitarian consequences have not diminished. And to understand and tailor responses to patterns of violence, one must understand variables that realistic thinking was ill-equipped to recognize. In this, all this debate to overcome strategic studies and create a broader understanding of the field of security takes place. In addition, we also have a new concept. Here we have a different pattern of violence, not only marked by profound institutional instability, but also by its profound impact on civil society. And with the presence of non-state actors, they thrive in this context of instability created by this conflict, such as transnational drug trafficking groups. These groups create a particular scenario because, from the moment they become central actors in the dynamic of violence, they do not enter this dynamic to support one side or the other. They are not interested in which side will win the war. They are more interested in the continuation of the state of instability generated by the violence than in the resolution of the war itself. So there we have a pattern of violence that is different, marked not only by deep institutional instability, but also by the profound impact on civil society disproportionate to the wars of the mid-20th century, but also because of the presence of these actors who see war as an end rather than war as a means. In this respect, we have the suggestion that we are no longer in the universe within which Clausewitz is thinking about the phenomenon of war, since for him, war serves a political purpose. Here we have actors who use the space of violence as a war economy. They reproduce and thrive within warfare. For those actors, war has become the new normal. This brings up a very peculiar scenario of violence. This brings the concept of new wars, which marks the reflection of this type of violence in the 90s, and it is also one of the elements that leads to the questioning of the extent to which the premises of strategic studies are useful for thinking about the patterns of violence that we are witnessing in the contemporary world. This is the question that begins to be asked. Thus, after the Cold War, there were fundamental changes, where it is possible to observe the new wars that occurred with more frequency in collapsed states. Mary Calder argues that these types of conflicts correspond to a new type of organized violence. They are fundamentally different from the traditional wars. In the new wars, it is not easy to distinguish the private and the public sphere, the state and what is non-state, and economic or political motives. They blur the distinctions between people, armies, and governments that come from a significant change in borders that used to be more rigid and well-defined. Also, unlike traditional wars, which had the public sphere as a scenario of violence, in new wars, civil society is simultaneously the stage and target of organized violence. The author's argument is that during the last decades of the 20th century, a new type of organized violence developed, especially in Africa and Eastern Europe, which is one aspect of the current globalized era. The term new is used to distinguish such wars from prevailing perceptions of war drawn from an earlier era. She uses the term war to emphasize the political nature of this new type of violence. Even though the new wars involve a blurring of the distinctions between war, organized crime, and large-scale violations of human rights. Critics of the New War argument have suggested that many features of the New Wars can be found in earlier wars, that the dominance of the Cold War overshadowed the significance of small wars or low-intensity conflicts. Mary Kondor argues that the main point of the distinction between New and Old Wars was to change the prevailing perceptions of war, especially among policymakers. She wanted to emphasize the growing illegitimacy of these wars and the need for a new political response. That is all. Thanks for watching.